Good morning, I'm Mike DeValio.
And I'm Nikki De Guzman.
Join us as we give you the rundown of the news you need to know today. In the headlines, the occupancy rate in intensive care units across the Philippines hits a record high as the surge in COVID cases continues.
Baguio City and two other provinces experiencing a rise in infections are placed under stricter quarantine.
The ICT department confirms the IP address involved in the cyber attacks against two media outlets was assigned to the Philippine military. We speak with Bulatlat Managing Editor Len Olea later on the program.
And the European Union seeks to have a common charger for all mobile phones in a blow to tech giant Apple.
Thank you for joining us. The provinces of Abra and Bohol, as well as Baguio City, placed under general community quarantine with heightened restrictions amid a rise in COVID cases. Malacanang says this will stay in effect until the end of the month. Under the stricter guidelines, dine-in services, personal care services, religious gatherings, and outdoor tourist attractions will be allowed to operate at a limited capacity. But even before the tighter quarantine was announced, the province of Benguet, where Baguio City is, had already imposed stricter health protocols. Benguet was earlier flagged by the Octa Research Group as an area of concern.
So essential travel na tayo yung ginagawa natin. Nag-check na sa border yan, kaya yung pila namin ng mga sasakyan mahaba na.
Kung pwede po, itantan muna ang pag-travel dito sa Benguet. Itong mabilis ang pagtaas ng kaso ng COVID, for our safety din naman po.
Ilocos Norte has meanwhile been de-escalated from a modified enhanced community quarantine to GCQ.
The Philippines logged 17,411 new COVID infections Thursday, raising the nationwide tally to 2,434,000. 177 more patients died, while another 14,000 recovered. The number of active cases stands at more than 165,000. The health department says the occupancy rate of intensive care units across the country has reached a record high of 79%. But apart from a shortage in hospital beds, manpower also remains a big issue. President Rodrigo Duterte earlier ordered the deployment of police and military medical personnel to help facilities in need of additional staff.
Quezon City inspects 13 orphanages and rehabilitation centers following a series of COVID-19 outbreaks in closed and long-term care facilities. Four religious compounds have been placed under special lockdown due to COVID. Dr. Rolly Cruz, head of QC Epidemiology and Surveillance Unit, says they are already looking into COVID-related deaths among the personnel of these facilities. Mayor Joy Belmonte, meanwhile, says the local government will also prioritize vaccinating residents of religious compounds.
Meralco will resume cutting unpaid electricity lines in Metro Manila next week. This comes after the capital region shifted to a looser pandemic alert level quarantine system. But the power distributor assures the public those under granular lockdowns will not be affected by the disconnection activities. There also won't be any disconnections yet in Bulacan, Cavite, Laguna, Rizal, Lucena City, and Quezon, which remain under modified enhanced community quarantine until September 30.
An additional 700,000 doses of Pfizer's COVID-19 vaccine have arrived in the Philippines. Our correspondent Jervis Manan has more details for us. Jervis, good morning.
Yes, good morning, Mike. Due to the steady supply of vaccines arriving in the country, the IATF is now preparing to give booster shots or third shots to our medical frontliners. Vaccine czar Carlito Galvez says this might be possible at the latter end of 2021 or the early months of 2022. They said they will wait for further scientific studies, but they are readying should the need arise. After all, the bulk of our vaccine purchases will be arriving this October to December. Last night, more than 728,000 doses of Pfizer vaccines arrived in the country. 51,000 were shipped to Cebu, while 92,000 were shipped to Davao City. Vaccine Czar Galvez noted that vaccination rate is increasing in Manila, Cebu, and Davao, and they are now focusing on vaccinating more people in Region 3 and Region 4A or Calabarzon, as a lot of people from these areas frequently go to Metro Manila. Galvez has also recommended to the president the vaccination of children aged 12 to 17. He says this will hasten the return to face-to-face classes. Some parents and families are skeptical about sending their children back to school if they aren't vaccinated. So far, Galvez says we can accommodate the vaccination of this population because we have a steady supply of vaccines now. He said vaccination should be done by February 2022 so we can focus on the upcoming elections in May next year. Mike.
Thanks for the update, Jervis Manahan. In other news, an agency under the Philippine ICT Department has confirmed that an IP address involved in the cyber attacks against independent media organizations Bulatlat and Altermedia, as well as Rights Coalition Karapatan, was assigned to the Philippine military. The Computer Emergency Response Team, or CERT-PH, noted more than 2,000 lines of logs with destination bulatlat.com. But its analysis did not prosper because the contact person from the Philippine Army did not respond to attempts to coordinate. Back in July, the Department of Science and Technology admitted they provided the IP address linked to the cyber attacks, but stopped short of naming the agency it was assigned to. So what does this new finding mean? To talk more about this, we're joined this morning by Ms. Len Ulea, Managing Editor of Bulatlat. Good morning, Len. Thanks for joining us.
Good morning, Mike. Good morning, Nikki. Thank you for the invitation.
All right, Len, first, how significant is this development? Because you already knew back in June, based on the report of Sweden-based digital forensics nonprofit Curium Media, that the attacks on your website involved the military, although the DOST would not confirm this. Now that it's out there, what does that mean?
Well, this is very significant, although, as you said, we already knew from the start that the attacks originated from an IP address assigned to the Philippine Army. But the fact that the DICT, particularly its CERT-PH, conducted the investigation and from their own investigation released a report confirming Curium Media's findings bolstered our suspicion from the start. So it proved that state agents are behind the cyber attacks against independent media outfits. And we also suspect that they are also behind the cyber attacks against human rights group Karapatan's website a month ago.
Now, Len, is this enough, though, to establish that cyber attacks on Bulatlat, Altermedia, even Karapatan are state-sanctioned? Can the military, in fact, say that perhaps just one person or a group of persons within the military could be behind this?
Well, of course, they could say that, but the problem is they did not cooperate with the DICT in the investigation. So that is really frustrating. If they are not guilty and they knew that only a group of persons are behind the attacks, they should have cooperated with the said government agencies. But despite repeated attempts to reach out to them, they did not even answer the emails from the CERT-PH. So what does that mean? So we went through the process of calling for accountability, demanding transparency, but this is what we got. So this is really frustrating for us.
Mm-hmm. Now refresh our minds, Len. When did you start noticing these attacks, and are there any patterns that you saw? I mean, which particular issues did you report on?
The DDoS attacks, or the distributed denial of service attacks, started actually in December 2018. If you can recall, we filed a case in 2019 against two IT companies where the attacks were traced. But after filing that case, the cyber attacks stopped. But the two IT companies did not mention who instructed them to conduct the cyber attacks. But from that time, we already knew that it would only be the state agents who had the motive to do that against alternative media outfits. And then in early this year, we, Curium, our hosting provider, and they are also handling the DDoS mitigation or the measures to mitigate the cyber attacks against our websites, noticed the series of attacks again. This time, they took notice of the vulnerability scan. No? Medyo technical siya, Mike, but it only means that it's an unauthorized scan of our website. This is akin to parang may bahay ka, no? So yung isang tao na hindi mo inauthorize would inspect kung okay ba yung security ng bahay mo. Ganun siya eh. I read a statement from the Philippine Army this today, no, this morning, saying that binisita lang naman namin yung website, but why do they accuse us of launching cyber attacks? Well, it's an unauthorized scan, so that is tantamount to an attack para sa amin, kasi they're trying to penetrate the website and trying to check if they can again launch DDoS or distributed denial of service attacks, which means ano siya eh, parang attempts to render the website inaccessible, parang to put down the website. So this is parang ano siya, kung sa ABS-CBN shutdown siya. Pero dito kasi dahil our only presence, ang platform lang namin ay website. So pag hindi na kami accessible sa website, para na rin kaming sinara.
No, so there is now an admission from the Philippine Army that they really were involved in those so-called cyber attacks. I mean, you call it attacks, they call it any other way, but you consider it attacks. So there is an admission, but have you had any opportunity to discuss this with them, this new finding?
Not yet, Mike, but we also sent them a letter, but we did not get any response. We wrote to the OST, the ICT, and the AFP around the same time. I think it was in July 5, to be exact. But we only got a response from the OST saying they would conduct an investigation and ask the DICT to proceed with the internal investigation. And this is what we got after a few months of waiting.
Mm-hmm. Now, were you able to identify the particular military officer to whom the email address indicated? I can just read it.
Yeah.
Exception ECJR at army.mil.ph. Were you able to identify which military officer was behind this email address that was linked to the military server?
No. Unfortunately, we have not identified the name of that officer because the Philippine Army refused to cooperate.
But were you able to identify which unit this particular email address belongs to?
Based on the findings of Curium, that email address is assigned to the intelligence service of the Philippine Army.
Mm-hmm. But no confirmation from the Philippine Army?
No confirmation. They just said that in one report that no, they are not the one launching the attacks. And they just said that visiting a website is not tantamount to cyber attacks.
Mm-hmm. So what steps do you intend to take against the Philippine military? And if you are able to identify this particular person, what would you want to do?
Well, we urge the DOST to release its findings because we were informed that they also did their own investigation. We challenged them to go public because this is a public interest issue and this is a press freedom issue. If they can do this to independent media websites, they can do this to other groups, especially this coming election. So, medyo nakakakaba, di ba? Na ganun-ganun lang na we would not cooperate with any investigation. They can just do what they want. So we must demand accountability, not only for the interests of the websites involved, but of course, in defense of democracy.
Mm-hmm. Now let's talk about the DOST, because the Undersecretary for Research and Development earlier told ANC in July that in general, any attack on an IP address that is malicious is not acceptable. And one consequence could be the removal of the IP address assigned. Now, are you going to ask for that?
Yes, we would definitely look into that. But they should, in the first place, respond to our request for information and let us know their actions. No? Kasi ang hirap naman na nanghuhula. Tapos nag-reply lang sila ng, ano, ng parang generic na we uphold your right to press freedom, but wala na silang sinabing detalye. So, ang hirap naman ng ganun. So, they're also accountable to the public because I think public funds and public machinery are being used in these attacks.
Mm-hmm. And you've talked about press freedom earlier, Len, and you are also the Secretary General of the National Union of Journalists of the Philippines. Explain to us how exactly this is a press freedom issue. If, for example, websites like Bulatlat and Alter Media are deprived of being accessed by their subscribers or by their users, how is this a press freedom issue exactly?
Well, unlike the big media outfits, we do not have that wide reach. But Bulatlat and other alternative media outfits, I believe, provide some kind of void. No? May mga issues kasi na talagang sa alternative media outfits nang pwedeng ilabas. For example, the gross human rights violations happening in the provinces, mining, etc., etc. And when our audiences are denied access to our websites, that is a violation of press freedom, a violation of their right to information, and a violation to our right to publish. No? As I said earlier, ito lang yung platform namin. Eh. We cannot go print. It's expensive. We can go to social media, yes, but we do not have the necessary funding and resources, no, to boost our posts, no, kasi alam naman natin na Facebook and Twitter, no, they're ang bilis matabunan, no, yung mga storya. So I think we are doing our small part in contributing to educating and raising the awareness of our of the public, and by denying us the right to publish, this is a violation of press freedom. And ang sabi ko nga, parang napakaliit na nga nung mga ano media outlets na ito, napakalimited na ng resources, bakit hindi niyo pahayaan na mag-operate peacefully? Kasi ano to eh, parang supposedly we're in a democracy. Pero just like what happened to the denial of franchise ng ABS-CBN, yung constant threats against other colleagues, no, in the media, ito naman sa maliliit na independent news outfits, patalikod naman yung ginagawang ano attack. So hindi talaga siya maganda. We're parang ano siya, additional weapon used against the Philippine media.
All right. Thank you so much for joining us this morning, Len Ulea, Managing Editor of Bulatlat.
Thank you again, CNY.
All right. In other news, President Rodrigo Duterte doubles down on his 2022 vice presidential bid, while the opposition continues to search for a standard bearer. Willard Chang reports.
President Rodrigo Duterte signed in Davao Wednesday night the Certificate of Nomination and Acceptance, or CONA, sealing his run for vice president under the PDP Laban faction headed by Energy Secretary Alfonso Cusi. The CONA is dated September 17 as the day of his nomination. PDP Laban Secretary General Melvin Matibag describes the move as a big step for the president's candidacy.
Everybody's excited. Everybody's preparing and gearing for the campaign in 2022.
Matibag hopes this will help nudge Senator Bongo into accepting the party's nomination to run for president. Meantime, the Magdalo Group, led by former Senator Antonio Trillanes IV, calls on Vice President Lenny Robredo to soon make a decision on her 2022 plans. Trillanes said the group is convinced that Robredo would win, and they are ready to support her Magda Lu says it is ready to fill the vacuum in case Robredo decides not to run. Trillanes adds, Senators Panfilo Lacson and Manny Pacquiao and Manila Mayor Isko Moreno, who have declared their presidential bids, are not the true opposition. In the meantime, in Moreno's camp, 23 local officials from Malabon, Bulacan, Tarlac, Zambales, Laguna, Batangas, Marinduque, Albay, and Romblon took their oath as members of Acción Democrático to support him and running mate Dr. Willie Ong. Moreno confirmed the party is in talks with incumbent senators and re-electionists who may join the party.
Lahat marami tayong kinakausap. And that includes some members of the administration. Some members of the opposition.
Moreno declined to give further details for now. Willard Cheng, ABS-CBN News.
Vice President Lenny Robredo still working to unite the broader political opposition for the 2022 elections. Robredo's spokesperson, Attorney Barry Gutierrez, says talks between the Vice President, Senator Manny Pacquiao, and Manila Mayor Isko Moreno Dumagoso continue, even if the two had already declared their presidential bids. This comes amid public clamor for Robredo to finally make up her mind and seek the presidency. But as early as now, Buchera says, Robredo supporters are already preparing for her candidacy.
She's serious about the responsibility of forging a broad coalition. It's not indecisiveness. In fact, it's the exact opposite. She is very decided that this is the way to go. This is the best way to go about it. The Liberal Party has been continuously organizing. It has continuously been preparing its own, well, admittedly limited machinery. Aside from LP, in the last three months or so, there have been a lot of volunteer groups that have come forward, individual citizens that have organized themselves to push for a Lenny Robredo run, and they're also moving. So it's not as if everything is in a state of stasis, like a suspended animation, while the vice president has yet to make an announcement. It's very clear to me that as soon as she makes the announcement, everything will be ready to go.
The Commission on Elections suspends the issuance of voter certification to focus on the registration process, which is set to end on September 30. Anjo Bagawisan joins us live for more updates. Anjo, good morning. What more can you tell us?
Good morning, right? Good morning, Mike. That's right. We have less than a week before the voters' registration for the 2022 general elections ends on September 30. And COMELEC offices and satellite offices or satellite sites throughout the country will have to focus their energies on preparing for this expected deadline. Now, the COMELEC announced Thursday that it has suspended the issuance of voter certification from Monday, this coming Monday, September 27, up to Thursday, September 30, which are the last 4 days of the voter registration. They say this is to lessen the burden on the COMELEC's limited field personnel, who are also, of course, assigned to the voter registration. Now, voter certification is issued in lieu of the voter's ID card and can be presented as a valid government ID when needed for transactions. However, the COMELEC said that voters can apply for and claim their voter certification at its main office in Intramuros in Manila. They may visit the COMELEC social media page on Facebook for details. Now, the COMELEC has repeatedly resisted calls to extend the voter registration period, which has, of course, been hampered by the pandemic and the succession of lockdowns throughout the Philippines. The Philippine Senate and the House of Representatives have also filed bills to ask the COMELEC to extend the deadline for a month, but the COMELEC said that this would delay its preparations for the elections. But the COMELEC said that they would comply if these bills in Congress get passed. Now, this September, COMELEC said that around 62 million and 470,000 voters have already registered. However, groups that are advocating for the extension of the voter registration say that over 70 million Filipinos are qualified to vote. That's a gap of 8 million unregistered voters. The COMELEC has said on Thursday that they are still open to conducting an extended 1 week of voter registration. That's after the filing of certificates of candidacy during the first 7 days of October. Meanwhile, we're here at the COMELEC registration site in Parañaque City, where hundreds of voters from the COMELEC or from the two legislative districts have arrived here to register. Many of them are first-time voters who came as early as 3 in the morning, 5 hours before the site opened. They're hoping that they can get in before the local COMELEC office implements its cutoff of registrants for the day. A 21-year-old who was the first in line told us that while it's late in the game to register, he said it's never too late to register because their voice is needed in the upcoming elections, especially coming from the youth. And there was a commotion earlier here when registrants from Parañaque's first district learned that the initially scheduled registration for them here was canceled and moved to another registration site. However, despite their appeals, police and the local COMELEC had their way and they continued to assert order here right now. So we're seeing the line of people continuously coming in as the voter registration is happening inside. Now, some registrants have encountered, or some prospective registrants have encountered problems, especially since they do not bring enough identification that are needed for their registration. So unfortunately for them, they might have to come back again tomorrow or in the coming week, as again, we have less than a week before the deadline for voter registration. Mike.
Andrew, I wonder how significant that extra 1 week period, or if the Senate and House bills will be followed, that 1 month period is for other people who want to register as voters for next year's elections. Seeing the lines that you're seeing now, how many do you think can be accommodated, you know, if they're given 1 week or another month to register?
Unfortunately, Mike, especially if we continue to see this these numbers of people who are coming, not just here in Parañaque, other registration sites here in Metro Manila, 1 week may not be enough to accommodate all of these people because, of course, these COMELEC sites have their own time limits. It's usually from 8 a.m. to 5 p.m. But even with COVID, but of course, you have the COVID health restrictions, which only allow for a much more limited number of people to come inside. So a lot of these people are actually hoping that they come in before that number of registration for each of the sites is achieved. And of course, COMELEC has tried to open satellite registration sites, which are in various malls around the country. But of course, a lot of people are still advocating that people be given additional time to register and take advantage of their right to vote. Mike.
And Angel, what about talks about moving registration sites to open areas so that you'd have less of restrictions for the regarding the pandemic? I mean, if they can actually accommodate filing of certificates of candidacies in open areas, can they do the same for registration of voters?
That, of course, Mike, is a possibility, but we haven't heard anything from the COMELEC regarding additional adjustments to the voter registration system. This one we reported right now, the suspension of voter certificate issuance, is but the first of measures we might be hearing from COMELEC in the coming days to assure that a lot more people would be able to vote while still sticking to their time schedule of ending the registration on September 30. Mike.
All right, thank you for that update, Andrew Bagawisan. Now here's a look at other stories we are tracking today. At 8 this morning, the Kilusang Bagong Lipunan will hold its national convention, where it is expected to announce its candidates for 2022. The party is supposedly eyeing former Senator Bongbong Marcos as its presidential bet. Our correspondent, Jackie Manabat, will be monitoring the event.
And at 2 in the afternoon, the Senate Blue Ribbon Committee will resume its probe into the government's allegedly overpriced pandemic purchases.
And we are taking a quick break. Up ahead, Philippine police release CCTV footage that could provide leads to the death of artist Bree Ponson.
And the European Union seeks to have a common charger for all mobile phones and a blow to tech giant Apple. These are more when the rundown returns. Stay tuned.
mobility will be key to recovery because we have relaxed some of our quarantine methods now, and we have allowed more transportation to come out. That's going to prove to be better for demand. If we do follow the health protocols, the ability of people to move around will likely contribute better to growth.
The greatest disruptor of all time is actually COVID-19. Because of limited mobility, people are also not being able to go to physical branches, etc. So it further accelerated the adoption of consumers of digital channels. We are now being able to provide the services needed by our citizens, by our consumers.
Welcome back to The Rundown. Philippine police released CCTV footage that could provide leads to the death of Filipino artist Bri Honson. Rafi Santos with the details.
Police have released security footage showing Bri Honson and Julian Ong Pin outside their rented room in La Union on September 18. According to the police, it is clear from the video that the pair had been arguing and were drinking alcohol sometime before Honson was found dead. An earlier forensic report stated her case of death as asphyxia, with Ong Pin claiming she had killed herself, which the victim's family denies. PNP Chief Guillermo Eliazar says the security footage and testimony from the hotel staff were now part of the investigation.
That is just one of the videos na nakita sa labas. Remember that the CCTV ay nasa labas, hindi naman siya nasa loob. So what happened inside ay wala pa tayong conclusion.
Eliazar says Ong Pin told investigators he forced through a bathroom door to get to Bri, leaving him with wounds on both his arms and back. No signs of struggle found on Honson's body except for a ligature mark on her neck.
One thing that they explained is that pataas kasi yung markings nung ligature. So pataas siyang paganon. So most likely talagang sa pataas siya. Pero yun nga, pwede naman kasi pataas na nakahang, pwede rin pataas na inangat, di ba? So all of these things are being considered during the conduct of the investigation.
However, lawyers representing the victim's family are contesting the statement, saying forensics found other marks on Honson's body. The police say they are not yet ruling out foul play in the young artist's death. Meanwhile, the NBI has also conducted its own autopsy on Honson's cadaver and are now awaiting its results. They've also begun talking to the victim's friends and relatives as part of a parallel probe requested by Honson's family. Rafi Santos, ABS-CBN News.
In business, President Rodrigo Duterte signs a law setting up a tax regime for Philippine offshore gaming operators. Under the measure, 60% of revenues collected from offshore gambling will be used for the universal healthcare program. 20% will go to the enhancement of medical facilities, while the remaining 20% will be allotted for sustainable development goals.
Bahagi ito sa ating mahigpit na pagre-regulate ng lahat ng klase ng gambling at pagbabawal ng illegal na sugal.
Senator Pia Cayetano earlier said FOGOs yielded 6.4 billion pesos in collections back in 2019. FOGOs were suspended in 2020 along with other non-essential businesses when the COVID-19 lockdown was imposed.
The Philippine Central Bank keeps key interest rates at record lows in a bid to spur economic recovery. It maintained the interest rate for overnight reverse repurchase facility at 2%. Interest rates on overnight deposit and lending facilities were also kept at 1.5% and 2.5%. The central bank also revised the country's 2021 inflation forecast to 4.4%, up from the previous 4.1% estimate. But it asserts inflation expectations remain firmly aligned with their projections.
On balance, the Monetary Board is of the view that prevailing monetary policy settings remain appropriate given the manageable inflation environment and uncertain growth outlook. The Monetary Board reiterates that together with appropriate fiscal and health interventions, keeping a steady hand on the BSP's policy levers will allow the momentum of economic recovery to gain more traction by helping boost domestic demand and market confidence.
Manila's ranking slips in the top 100 list of emerging global startup ecosystems. The Startup Genomes 2021 report showed the Philippine capital placed within the 91 to 100 rank or those at earlier stages of growth. In last year's report, Manila was within the 31 to 40 rank. Mumbai, meanwhile, topped the list. The report said Manila's strengths are in financial technology and e-commerce and having affordable talent. The Trade Department vows to work on improving the performance of the Philippine startup ecosystem.
The European Union aims to have a common charger for all mobile phones, a move that will affect tech giant Apple more than its rivals. Under the proposal, a USB-C connector will become the standard port for all smartphones, tablets, and other gadgets. Chargers will also be sold separately from electronic devices. The EU denies targeting Apple, saying it only acted because companies were not able to agree on a common solution, despite a decade of talks. Apple is pushing back against the proposal since iPhones are charged from Lightning cables, while Android devices are charged using USB-C connectors.
A look now at the financial markets. Wall Street rallied for a second straight day as investors appeared relieved about the U.S. Federal Reserve's stance on tapering stimulus and raising interest rates. All the major indices added more than 1% each, with the Dow gaining over 500 points. Thursday's jump pushed Wall Street back into the green this week. Over in Europe, stocks also closed higher as investors reacted to the latest policy decisions from the Bank of England and the US Fed. The optimism also spilled here in Asia, with markets rising after the Fed's signal. The The PSEI was up for a third straight day.
Now here are some economic data releases we are monitoring this Friday. Malaysia will post its August inflation rate. Consumer prices in Malaysia declined to 2.2% in July. This was the lowest inflation rate since March, mainly due to the monthly electricity discount given to domestic consumers amid the COVID-19 lockdown. Singapore will report its August manufacturing output. Singapore's manufacturing production grew by 16.3% in July, missing market forecasts of 20.2%. Still, it was the ninth straight month of gain. Economic activities continued following an acceleration of COVID vaccinations. And Italy will come out with its September consumer confidence figures. Consumer confidence in Italy fell to 116.2 in August. It still beat forecasts and remains well above pre-pandemic levels.
Air rage incidents in the U.S. have jumped sharply since regulators moved to impose fines back in January. But as this report tells us, the number of incidents remains high.
Air rage is on the decline in the United States after new fines were put in place in January, but the number of incidents is still twice as high as last year, according to Federal Aviation Administration data released on Thursday. As of last week, reported occurrences involving unruly airline passengers were 6 per 10,000 flights. That's a 50% drop from earlier this year. FAA Administrator Steve Dixon, in a statement, said even one incident is one too many and called air rage a, quote, serious safety threat. Numbers remain high compared to a year ago as some flyers balk at a federal face mask mandate on airplanes. Hundreds of passengers have been banned from some airlines and some have faced $9,000 in federal civil fines for defying mask requirements. Airline staff have been on the receiving end of much of the rage, leading some airlines to cancel sales of alcoholic beverages on flights. Airline unions have called on Attorney General Merrick Garland and the Department of Justice to prosecute disruptive and violent air passengers. Senior Democratic lawmakers on Monday also requested the same from the Attorney General.
An advisory panel of the U.S. Centers for Disease Control and Prevention recommends booster shots of Pfizer's COVID vaccine. The recommendation only covers Americans age 65 and older and some adults with underlying medical conditions, living out adults who live or work in institutions at high risk for COVID-19. The CDC decision comes a day after the U.S. Food and Drug Administration also authorized booster shots for seniors. This clears the way for a rollout to begin as soon as this week for millions of people who had their second dose of the Pfizer shot 6 months ago.
Aside from booster shots for its own population, U.S. President Joe Biden says America will also be doubling its global COVID-19 vaccine donations. That story and more from our North America correspondent, Henny Espinosa.
Good morning, Mike and Nikki. Here are the latest stories making headlines amongst the Filipino community. The U.S. has promised to buy 500 million more COVID-19 vaccine doses to donate to other countries amid growing pressure to share its supply with low to lower middle income countries.
This is another half billion doses that will all be shipped by this time next year. And it brings our total commitment to donated vaccines to over 1.1 billion vaccines to be donated.
Biden calls the COVID-19 pandemic an all-hands-on-deck crisis. More than 4.7 million people all over the world have lost their lives to the virus. Over 6 billion doses of the COVID-19 vaccine have been administered globally. In entertainment news, in early 2022, Inigo Pascual will make his Hollywood TV debut in Monarch, Fox Entertainment's country music-themed family drama, co-starring with Susan Sarandon and Anna Friel. Pascual plays Sarandon's adopted grandchild from the Philippines and will sing original music as well as covers. Acting and singing are nothing new to this young star, but speaking with a southern accent is.
I have been doing a lot of dialect coaching with my coach. I'm so challenged with it when I'm on set. Every time it motivates me to work even harder in that aspect.
Monarch will release its premiere episode on Fox with a special two-night event starting January 30.
And those were the latest headlines from North America. You can catch our stories online at news.abs-cbn.com/TFC News and on the ABS-CBN News YouTube channel. Back to Mike and Nikki for the rundown.
Thank you, Henny. Tedros Ghebreyesus, poised for a second term as head of the World Health Organization. Tedros was nominated by at least 17 European Union members and backed by countries in other regions. Some diplomats told Reuters they were unaware of other names being put forward, suggesting Tedros will stand unopposed in the May election. Under the WHO process, envelopes are to remain sealed until after October 29, meaning it cannot be ruled out that a country might nominate another candidate. A former health and foreign minister of Ethiopia, Tedros was elected as the WHO's first African director general in May 2017. He has led the global fight against the COVID pandemic, steering the agency through attacks on its handling of the crisis.
The U.S. Special Envoy to Haiti resigns in protest over what he calls the inhumane treatment of Haitian migrants at the U.S.-Mexico border. Daniel Foote blasted the Biden administration for deporting hundreds of migrants back to the crisis in Gulf Caribbean region. Says conditions in Haiti were so bad that U.S. officials were confined to secure compounds. He adds the collapsed state is unable to support the infusion of returning migrants. The U.S. has returned more than 1,400 migrants to Haiti and taken another 3,000 into custody. Meanwhile, the White House says horses will no longer be used at the border of Del Rio, Texas, after images surfaced of a U.S. border guard on horseback charging at migrants. An investigation into the incident is underway.
One, we feel those images are horrible and horrific. There is an investigation the president certainly supports, overseen by the Department of Homeland Security, which he has conveyed will happen quickly. I can also convey to you that the secretary also conveyed to civil rights leaders earlier this morning that we would no longer be using horses in Del Rio. So that is something, a policy change that has been made in response.
The U.S. reaffirms the applicability of the Mutual Defense Treaty to the South China Sea. Lindsay Ford, U.S. Deputy Assistant Secretary of Defense for South and Southeast Asia, says America remains committed to coming to the Philippines' aid in case of an attack in the disputed waters. She adds Washington is dedicated to supporting the Philippine military's modernization efforts. Without naming Beijing, she notes hostile actions in the South China Sea create new threats to the economic security, defense, and sovereignty of countries.
We are absolutely committed to ensuring that we work alongside the Philippines to make sure that they have the necessary capabilities to defend, for the Philippines to defend its own interests, and for us to ensure that collectively the alliance has the ability to address some of the new threats and challenges we see in the security environment.
Our security cooperation with the U.S. is vital in securing advanced weapon systems towards having a minimum deterrence capability against external threats. Keeping our alliance robust is well within the interest not only of the Philippines and the United States, but also of the whole Indo-Pacific region.
Let's get an update on the weather now from Pagasa weather forecaster Raymond Ordinario. Good morning, Raymond. What can you tell us?
Yes, Nikki, good morning. And this is our forecast for the next 24 hours. Currently, easterlies is affecting the Luzon area, and we are expecting a generally fair weather condition all throughout the country, including Metro Manila, with some chances of isolated rain showers or thunderstorms that will be more frequent in the afternoon or evening. Here in Metro Manila, the temperature will range from 25 to 34 degrees Celsius, while 16 to 26 in Baguio City and in Metro Cebu area, around 25 to 32 degrees Celsius. Nikki, as of now, we don't have any gale warning raised in any seabirds of our country, meaning to say that our fisher folks and or those who have small sea crabs can freely venture out to the sea because we're just expecting a slight to moderate sea condition. And right now, we're monitoring a tropical storm outside the Philippine area of responsibility, and we're expecting it to enter our area on Sunday evening. So we just keep posted on the information released by PAGASA regarding this upcoming tropical cyclone that will enter over the weekend. And that's the latest from the Weather Forecasting Center of Pagasa, Raymond Ordinario reporting.
All right, thanks for that update, Raymond Ordinario.
Meanwhile, Johnny Depp bags the top prize at the San Sebastian Film Festival in Spain. As this report tells us, the Hollywood star decried so-called cancel culture during his acceptance speech.
No one is safe as long as someone is willing to say one sentence.
Movie star Johnny Depp decried the so-called cancel culture at the San Sebastian Film Festival, where he was due to receive the event's top award.
It's so far out of hand now that I can promise you that no one is safe. Not one of you. Not one of you. Not anyone out that door. No one is safe as long as someone is willing to say one sentence. It takes one sentence. And then there's no more ground. The carpet's been pulled.
Last year, Depp lost a libel battle with a British tabloid that labelled him a wife beater when a London court ruled he had repeatedly assaulted his former partner, US actor Amber Heard.
My life with Johnny.
Since then, Depp has complained of being boycotted by Hollywood. The 58-year-old ascended to Hollywood stardom in the 1990s with portrayals of loners and outsiders in cult classics such as John Waters' Cry Baby and Tim Burton's Edward Scissorhands. He became a household name with the Disney franchise Pirates of the Caribbean, playing fan favorite Jack Sparrow. But he was replaced with a third film in the Fantastic Beasts franchise following the verdict against him in the London libel trial. His latest film, Minamata, struggled to secure a US release. Feminist groups and film industry associations criticized San Sebastian's Film Festival's decision to honor Depp when the award was announced in August.
For you.
Responding to that criticism, festival director Jose Luis Rebordinos said the award was a reflection of Depp's cinematic achievements and unrelated to his personal life.
I'm deeply honored.
Let's now talk to Ms. Karen Davila for today's guests on Head Start. Good morning, Ms. Karen.
Hello, good morning, Mike and Nikki. It's been a while since we spoke. Mm-hmm. And today we'll be speaking with Manila Mayor Isko Moreno, who's declared his intention to run for the presidency in 2022. So we'll ask about his strategies, criticisms against him, and his choice. People who are saying he may not be ready for the job. What will happen with the unification of the opposition as well?
Yeah, I'm sure 1 hour won't be enough. And Nikki, mm-hmm. you have a question for Manila Mayor Isko?
I'm actually more waiting for Ms. Karen's questions.
All right, we can discuss your questions off air. Thank you, Ms. Karen, for joining us after a while. And that's the rundown today. I'm Mike Navalio. You can watch highlights, recaps, and exclusive content of our shows online.
And I'm Nikki De Guzman. Subscribe to the ANC YouTube channel, like us on Facebook, and follow us on Twitter. Head Start comes your way next. Stay with ANC.
Ensure your safety after an earthquake. Be prepared for aftershocks. Don't